Thank you very much for coming. Thanks for being here. There's 13 other rooms that are all happening at the same time, so it's fantastic to see a full room here. I'm on the panel with two amazing people. It's a real honour to be here, and thank you so much for giving up your valuable time to talk to the crowd, and talk with the crowd, I should say, because the way that rights concessions work is that we try to have a dialogue as opposed to... And the reason of experts is here on the panel. Maybe I could just get to introduce yourselves a little bit and then we can talk. And I should say also that I'm, even though I sound like the moderator, I'm also a participant in the panel as well. It's kind of like a co-moderated discussion. We're trying something new. So,
Hi, everybody. I'm Cindy Cohen, Electronic Frontier Foundation, Cisco. While we do have all over the world, I think our particular focus is much more about U.S. domestic situation, which otherwise I would be sad to have someone else expertise in the EU. So I'm hopeful that we'll have a nice.
Hello, my name is Michael O'Flaherty. I'm director of the European Union Fundamental Rights Agency, sometimes known as the FRA. And the FRA's role is to be the independent body that advises the EU institutions and EU member states for compliance with their human rights commitments. We're based in Vienna.
So, in a way, you couldn't have two better people on this panel in terms of experts on human rights within the US jurisdiction and also within the European jurisdiction, and actually the interplay between the two as well, which is causing significant challenges for tech companies, for users, for law enforcement, etc. So if we think about the kind of trajectory of human rights over history, you know, obviously the Universal Declaration of Human Rights kind of codified rights in the modern era, and we have a whole set of issues that are set out, codified, with many pieces of analysis, precedent, jurisdictional questions, etc. How significant, and this panel is actually about Trump and Brexit. So how do we actually think about these two incidents in terms of like the history of human rights and the challenges to human rights? And what do these incidents actually signify, do you think? And I'll say that we're gonna try and do this panel, rather than like whinging and complaining, we're gonna do a little section on sort of identifying what some of the issues are. And then Michael was very clear, he's like, I just want to get to it. I want to get to solutions, not just in this panel, but in terms of like the things that need doing. So we're going to do some section on sort of identification of like the issues that we're dealing with, and then move swiftly, all of us, into a kind of a solution phase in the discussion.
Will I jump in? Yeah, well, it's way more than, don't reduce it to Trump and Brexit. Today we're facing a situation that comes from many sources and has been building up over quite a time. The value of right now is that the issues have become crystallized, which is why I think we can do the business of responding and not just whinging. Three elements, very briefly. First, as always, we have unacceptable levels of human rights abuse. It's never been any different. It's always unacceptable. It's high. It's high also here in Europe, where, for example, we failed to deal with the migration crisis. Second, though, and this is new, we have a walking away from human rights commitments by too many leaders, too many states, too many governments, saying the system no longer matters. That's new. That's frightening. If you think back even to the Bush era, where with Guantanamo Bay and Abu Ghraib and things of that nature, bad stuff happened, but they went to great lengths to deny bad stuff was happening because they still invested in the system and in the framework. We're seeing that slipping away in many places, including in Europe. And then the third and final element of the problem, as far as I'm concerned, is that the people for whom the human rights system was designed, the people of our communities and our societies, don't get it anymore. They're not convinced that it's a framework that brings value for them. It's seen as a framework that brings value for others, somebody else, somebody, frankly, that I wouldn't invite into my house for dinner. And we've got to reclaim the people on the streets, in my case of Europe, if the system is to have any future at all.
Thanks. You pick up on that first issue of like of movement, the freedom of movement of refugees. And one of the things that we're seeing in the US is like extraordinary, is that there's now like a number of different restrictions that we're seeing at the border. So restrictions as to people actually having to provide their social media accounts, their handles. Now there's also, potentially as a condition to entry, people having to provide their passwords to their social media accounts. Then there's the point about devices as well and not being allowed to be in bags, devices that are larger than an iPhone. So all of these restrictions on movement are a really interesting thing, both within Europe and within the US. Do you want to reflect upon that?
No, I think that that's exactly right. And I think Michael's put his finger on it in terms of the human rights structure. I often say that, you know, one of the things that I worry about in human rights is that we seem to have lost the humans, right? It's become a bureaucracy, it's become a structure, it's become abstract from people. And so because this structure doesn't appear to be working, and I think it doesn't work for the kinds of people who are in favor of those kind of border restrictions, as well as for the people who are trying to come across the border, who are trying to flee a situation, it seems irrelevant to this struggle to too many people, when it ought to be directly relevant to this struggle about and the questions. And I think that that underlying problem is the one that we have to grapple with. Otherwise, everything else is just Band-Aids. Having said that, EFF, we're big into the Band-Aids, right? We're going to be bringing a lawsuit based upon the searches of devices and demanding of protests at the border. We're gathering stories now. There's a place, if you have some stories, you can bring them in there. We're probably going to start with U.S. persons because there's lots of ways in which that's an easier lawsuit to win. But we're hoping that it will help set standards for these kinds of things and that will be applicable beyond just, you know, the easiest people to get protection for under U.S. law as it currently sits. So we'll be doing a lot of that. We're going to continue to be doing it and continue to be talking about it. But I do think for those of us who care about human rights, and I, you know, I'm a U.S. litigator, but I spent a year in Geneva at the Center for Human Rights, and I've done a lot of human rights litigation as well. So this is something I really care about, and I feel like we have failed to sell ordinary people and to make them feel like these rights, these lofty things, have relevance to their particular lives. And so, of course, they don't seem relevant as they're trying to decide how to grapple with problems that they're facing.
I think that's absolutely right. And we as a human rights organization, Access Now, like, we actually see ourselves at the intersection of human rights and new technology, which is a really interesting development, because obviously before, there's always been technology, you know, in the world of various forms, but this new technology and the impact on human rights and the impact of human rights on new technology, and it provides a lot of opportunity, a huge amount of opportunity, but it also, like, provides us with significant risks and challenges. Part of it, as you say, is about mainstreaming human rights in the digital age. And I think if we just stick on this issue of, like, the freedom of movement and refugees, and how refugees are actually using new technology to help with their pathway, to understand, like, to cross borders, to get to speak to loved ones. The most important thing from a rights perspective and from a human perspective is that they have access to their mobile device. Can you talk a little bit to that in the European context?
Yeah. About 14 months ago, I visited a refugee reception center, a so-called hotspot, for the first time in Greece, and I saw a tree that I didn't understand. It was a stump out of which flowed about 100 white lines, and it was a charger for the mobile phones. I've never seen anything quite like it before or since, and it vividly brought home to me how absolutely essential technology is for a migrant today. The tech world has a huge capacity to assist migrants right now. For example, one of the issues is getting basic information about your rights in a language you'll understand. And it's surprisingly difficult to get the apps developed and get them onto the phones of the people who need them with that sort of basic messaging. So that's one example. But also, we just have to recognize, whether it be in the refugee context or in any other, that the human rights system that we built up since the Second World War is as relevant online as offline. Its protections as well as its restraints on interference with human rights. The privacy rights, the expression rights, they've been hard won by. They're powerful. And somehow we don't seem to be succeeding in conveying the message, in particular to states, that there isn't a separate rule for privacy, rather no rule for privacy online, whereas there's a well-developed one elsewhere.
Mm. So I think people probably know that the Human Rights Council passed a resolution in 2012 to say that human rights apply equally online as they do offline. But of course, it's very difficult to translate. And I think that, you know, if you look at the right to freedom of expression, it says through any medium, which means whether it's print or radio or digitally or, like, on Facebook or on WhatsApp. But of course, governments and the US government and the UK governments and others are forming, passing laws that would actually restrict those rights. So where those rights might have been acceptable or respected within jurisdictions offline, they're now actually being criminalized or penalized online. Can you talk to any of the laws that you're seeing in either of those jurisdictions? For example, there's a censorship law that's being proposed in Germany yesterday. And does anybody in the audience know about that particular? No, okay. It's very significant. I got a number of emails about it this morning, a new law that's being proposed by one of the most important democracies globally, which would significantly limit the right to freedom of expression.
Just one thing, we need to slow democracy down. Part of the problem right now is that law is being developed far too fast, and there isn't a chance for the serious debate and reflection. I think we sometimes stumble into human rights abusive laws. They're not always a calculated strategy. And so I think we need better persistent advocacy. I say we've just realized that the fast solution is invariably going to be the problem. If you don't adopt, for example, you weaken the approaches. Mm.
Do you have any reflections on that? I mean, in particular, on the right to privacy, like we've seen in the US context, significant violations on the right to privacy, and I'm thinking particularly on this massive surveillance infrastructure that's been established in the US, not just with respect to US citizens, but under 12333 and 702, the capacity for the US government to surveil non-US citizens.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a huge problem. It's one I've spent the last decade fighting. And I think that, you know, in the US context, there's some differences. I think that we're seeing the same kind of lack of feeling of connection to the idea of human rights in multiple jurisdictions. But in the United States, the idea that human rights were important to individuals in their everyday life has never caught on. It was easily characterized as the province of the elites trying to tell the rest of us how to be. And I think that a lot of the problem in bringing a human rights framework into the US system is that it never took root in the way that the idea of, say, constitutional rights has taken root in the United States. And that's under risk too right now. But the human rights framework was always seen as something that was elite and abstract and not useful to people in their everyday lives. So it was pretty easy to jettison it, right? And so people come in with human rights arguments in courts, and I have written them. You know, you kind of get dismissed. And so I think we have to go back to the first conversation, which is, you know, why, what do we care about in human rights, and are they really universal? And we have to start to make that case. Nobody wants the police to come in the middle of the night and take your father away. Yeah. Nobody wants that. It's cross-cultural. Nobody, you won't go to any other corner of the world and find somebody in some other culture who's going to say, you know, I thought it was okay when the police came and took my dad. So they are universal, but we haven't made the pitch. And without that pitch, the idea that human rights are powerful, they're important, they're useful, they're worth standing up for, doesn't seem particularly relevant to people. So that's one of my pitches. I mean, but we're seeing these attacks. We're certainly seeing, you know, and there's a couple of reasons why the mass surveillance strategy is getting accepted all around the world. But part of it is that they don't see there isn't a sense of an outer boundary of government behavior that's important to people, as opposed to abstract and written in some book somewhere.
I agree with Cindy. We need to make the pitch, but we need to do more than that. We need to show the relevance for the immediate experience of people who live around us. Take another area. You gave the example of national security. I take the example of inequality. Inequality, which translates into poverty for an unacceptable number of Europeans, makes people uneasy, restless. It feeds into this populist strategy of some politicians. We need to bring a human rights focus, glare on inequality to improve the situation for people around Europe. If we can demonstrate that human rights makes a difference by allowing me to put clothes on the backs of my children, put a dinner on the table in the evening, that's when we'll convince people that it's worth investing in.
I might just throw to the audience at this point. Is there anything that people would like to comment on in terms of, in terms of anything that's been said, both in sort of the mainstreaming of human rights, the issue of like how do we pitch, how do we make it relevant to citizens? And I think in the context of like the populist movements that we're seeing, remember this panel is about Trump and Brexit and what the impact of... No, that's fine. And that's what I'm here for, to ensure that we start to think about what is the consequences of these nationalist populist movements which changing political infrastructure and how that might impact people's understanding of human rights, their enjoyment of it, and their connection to it. Yep, there's two comments here and a couple over there. Do we have a mic? Yeah. Thank you. So we'll take a few questions. One, two, three, and then I got you, yeah.
Well, this is not a question. It's just to pick up on my EU-Irish friend.
Could you introduce yourself as well?
Yes, I will in a second. Yeah. Yeah. My name is John Maguire. I work for France Media Monde, and it's just to pick up, excuse me, on what, it's Michael, right?
Yeah.
What you said about the Greek situation with all the mobile phones. Together with Deutsche Welle, ANSA, which is the Italian news agency, and the Open University in England, we have launched an app for migrants called infomigrants.net, which is doing exactly what you proposed, which is giving information, very neutral information, to would-be migrants, would-be asylum. If you look at it, it's info word.
Thank you. You'll read the URL at the bottom of the screen, because we are live streaming this as well. So people should note that they should see the image. Next question or comment. Sir?
My name is Tori Eggerman, and I am really interested in what you're saying about how we can speak about human rights in a more, well, let's just say populist manner. So I'd love to hear examples of this from people. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Yep, there's someone in front of you. And maybe people in the audience can have a think about like good examples of like popularizing human rights. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Victoria. I work with Open Media. Michael, I really loved your point about the things that were happening before feeling like they weren't affecting ordinary people. And I think you made a similar point as well. I'm wondering, with some things getting quite obviously worse for people, what opportunities do you think there are for those of us in charities and civil service or society organizations to turn that around and to kind of harness some of that outrage? So I'm thinking, for example, of the border privacy issue that you mentioned. It's always been legal for border agents to go through people's phones, but now the idea that it's going to be a matter of routine makes people think, oh my God, my naked selfies, etc. And I know there's a lot of stuff right now that is looking like politicians are now looking at changing the status quo, in fact, because of these new threats that are coming out. Are there other examples of things like that and ways that we should be working to kind of harness that outrage?
Well, I think one of the benefits of this kind of dark time in the United States is the commonality of purpose now. When things are good, sometimes people who generally agree with each other get into huge swearing fights at each other about small things. Right now, I feel a unity of purpose because of the big things that people share. So, something similar but smaller happened in the United States by the middle of the Bush administration when Abu Ghraib came out, and when the mass surveillance started being revealed. We had lots of friends in these fights, and then Mr. Obama got arrested, arrested, listen to me. Did not. That was just a...
That was fake news.
It's day. This rights concert going on for a while now. I'm starting to lose it. Mr. Obama got elected, and suddenly a lot of our friends went away. And we didn't have support for a lot of the things we're doing. I'm welcoming all of those people back now to the fights against mass surveillance. They're showing up. And I think a great example of this was what happened at the airports, right? When the Obama administration, I'm just going to keep doing this. You guys just insert the right name here. When Mr. Trump's EO came out and there were people caught in the airports, the number of people who showed up at the airport didn't even know what they were going to do, really, and just hung out. Of course, warmed my heart because people were chanting, "Where are the lawyers?" I love that. But that was pretty amazing, and it was the kind of thing that people who think about what ordinary people might do and how people do political activism in the United States would never have said could have happened, right? So the struggle for us, the challenge for us as EFF, as people who fight these kind of fights, you know, in good weather and bad, is now that we have, you know, bad weather such that there are a lot more people on our side, how do we harness that? How do we make that happen? We know that in the United States, more people voted for the other person than the one who got elected, right? So as a numbers matter, we have more people. How do we harness them now that they're ready to do something? How do we keep that energy up? How do we find opportunities for people to make their voice heard? That feels empowering rather than disempowering. Those are all the challenges that we have.
Can you answer one of those challenges? Like, I mean, I think just to pick up on the question earlier about sort of how do we, I think this idea of like popularizing human rights, like actually using the populist movement in the direction that we want it to go as opposed to the one which is, you know, concerned about borders, fearful of migrants, absolutely prepared to sacrifice their right to potential loss of, you know, life, to their right to privacy and freedom of expression, et cetera. Like, how do we popularize rights? And let's think of, like, some specific examples.
Can I?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. Look, first, I'm uncomfortable with the language of populism. It kind of makes the people out there the problem, and they're not the problem. It's simply about giving people what is theirs, their human rights, and making them meaningful for them in their day-to-day lives. So, John, you gave an example. You know, developing that app is an example of how you make human rights relevant for people who need it in real time. Another thing is get local. We're doing a lot of work increasingly now on helping cities to become human rights respectful and to hardwire human rights into the way they make their decisions. That then gets very close to you. It's about the garbage, the refuse disposal. It's about the allocation of public housing. I worked in Northern Ireland for a few years, NGOs, civil society groups, worked with working class people in one of the most deprived corners of the city of Belfast to use a human rights approach to demand housing and to get it fairly distributed. And that's the reason today that if you go to that place, against all the logic of populism, you find a community of working class people, many unemployed, who are passionate about human rights because it made a difference for them in their lives. And if I could say one last thing, since this is mainly a tech group in the room, and you use the word, how do we express the outrage? I would say we need you to express smart outrage. There are some areas right now where we don't know the answers and we need your help to find the answers. For example, I just said very easily, glibly, and we all agreed, that human rights is as relevant online as offline. But we don't know what that means. Encryption. How do you engage with encryption meaningfully until you figure out in a really challenging way what human rights says to the encryption debate? What does it say to the interoperability of large-scale databases debate? Things of that nature. You've got to sit with us and help us figure out the answers to those questions. So, in other words, the outrage isn't just on the street, isn't just in a working-class corner of Belfast. It's in communities such as yours. And frankly, despite an amazing event like this, I think we need more of it.
I just want to emphasize that. I found that sometimes people get into human rights because there's something abstract out there and international that is a little more comfortable for them than talking to the people who are right in their communities. You know, it's easier to care about, I may be just projecting, but it's easier to care about Tibet and the people far away from you who are in trouble than it might be sometimes to think hard about the problems that you walk by every day. And I think that one of the things that people who care about human rights have to do is a little more of that and a little, not less than that, but to find a better balance. And again, for me, this is, I mean, I am not a big thinker, philosopher person. I'm a strategist. I am really good at driving the bus from here to there. And I think if we want to drive the bus from here to human rights, we have to start talking to, we have to start making the pitch to the people who we're with every day, not just the people who we fly to Brussels to have nice parties with.
However.
not that they're not nice parties.
However, the infrastructure of the human rights framework itself is at risk. And the bodies that are actually implementing the treaties are under-resourced. For example, and under-resourced and under-disrespected and vulnerable and actively attacked by member states who are meant to be the ones who are upholding those rights. So, for example, we heard two weeks ago, that the US government was considering withdrawing from the Human Rights Council. Now, the Human Rights Council is a fraught body, but it is also the body that's responsible for passing that resolution that I mentioned before. It's the body that the Special Rapporteurs on Freedom of Expression and Privacy reports of, so David Kaye and Joe Kanatachi, who are both here. And so we need to, perhaps not popularize, but to mainstream or to make human rights relevant to people in the digital age. But we also need to understand that the very infrastructure that supports and enables and authorizes and legitimizes those rights is also at risk. So I think it's a multifaceted approach. Yeah. I might throw back to the audience because there's a number of people, unless you wanted to make a quick response.
No, I really just want to agree with you. This system is at risk and it's critical that we don't abandon it. There's no plan B. This is it. This is the thing that got us out of the chaos of the Second World War, and without it, we face an appalling vista. Mm.
Thank you for that. All right, so there's a comment up the back. Bruce Schneier at the front as well. Oh, yes. So.
No, start with the woman in red. She's been waiting.
Yep. So, yeah, do you mind? We'll pass the microphone back, and then we'll bring it back to you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Thank you, sir.
I didn't know she had.
No, that's fine.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. My name is Shola Zamini. I am, call it now, Iranian-Austrian, so we work on human rights in Iran. And I am a minority in Austria, so because I come from Iran, not from Austria. But then we work very much on rights of demonstrations, for example, in Iran, as well as all other rights. And then when we are in Austria and we hear after all kinds of hate speeches that goes through presidential election, you all have followed it very much, I suppose, that the Interior Minister wants to limit the rights of demonstrations in Austria because there are too many numbers of demonstrations, then we get this feeling, okay, the way is going other round. I mean, there are too many demonstrations because people have the feeling that they are not heard really, or there are something that should be changed. This is not the right way, not to limit the demonstrations. And then one comes to the feeling, oh gosh, that is not the right place now anymore. I mean, at the time being, I have never had this kind of feeling in Austria as well as after the presidential election and after all these hate speeches. I always had this feeling, I am safe now here. I was not safe in Iran, but now I am safe here. But now I'm not sure if this populist way of speaking in media, which is very much amplified in media as well, if I have this feeling anymore. So it's as bad as Iran, I know that. But still, this gives us the pitch, is it the right way that we are going in Europe as well?
Thank you. So. There's not a second mic, is there?
Hi, my name is Filip Stojanovski. I come from Macedonia, and we have an experience of this populism turning a country into authoritarian with authoritarian tendencies for the last 11 years. And it's really possible for any democracy, and it's a trend also in other countries in Eastern Europe. It's really possible that democracy can turn into this sort of anti-democracy in a very short time. And the experiences that we have in this region are copied between countries, multiplied, yeah. And it is very concerning if that is replicated in the Western Europe too. What is really important to take note is that we all have taken human rights for granted because they are enshrined in our in our laws. The UN framework, it's the highest law of the land and so on. However, it is really, it turned out that when there is a state capture, when this populist wave brings about, let's say, submission of the judiciary or other elements of separation of, the next step is erasure of separation of powers and then subverting the judiciary.
Yeah.
Then it is really hard to make people capable of fighting that. You need a really large popular support, and it's it is best to be prevented. And like you said, the time is now. Yeah. Any type of, and what is really important from our experience is that these populists are bullies. They only respond to power. They don't respond to arguments. They don't respond to irony. They don't. They would respond only if they see that you stand up to them and that there is something that can really prevent what they're doing. So
I'll just limit access. Brexit happened and concern. In the US and in Costa Rica and in around the world. This team was devastated. Like, experience of our lives. We've just come out of experience and we've learned solutions. And it's about, you know, a movement of rights respecting citizens or rights citizens who are looking for rights and prepared to fight for them and to demonstrate, as you also mentioned as well. The thing is, as you also say, is like, how do you actually preempt this? Like, how do we, as we slide away from democracy, how do we do some of these preemptive actions?
He was headed. So yeah. I'm wondering if you have suggestions for us.
You said how to turn around this, you cannot tap into the populist rhetoric and turn it around, because irony is dead once populism starts. Mm-hmm. Even so, the narrative of human rights should be, just look at the historical experiences in Europe in the last century. We have faced similar situation before in the first part of 20th century. It was not by trying to ridicule the outrageous claims or whatnot, but mm-hmm. by pressing the actual essence of the problem in a very simple terms and in a very consistent and continuous way. Yes. Because it's otherwise you just fall into a trap.
Yeah.
Because just like with the fake news thing.
Thank you.
If I could respond to you, don't try and persuade populists, undermine them. There's no point in attempting to persuade the people of the type you describe. And I agree with you and the previous speaker, not only about how bad things can get, but how worrying the situation is across a number of European states. I'll give two things we can do, practical things. The first is use law much more. A populist can say he or she will do something dreadful, but there's a legal framework in there, this human rights system we've been discussing, which you can use. Use it in the courts, use it in advocacy, use it more. It sets red lines, and they're not insignificant, they're not powerless. The second thing is populism is fed by lies, so we need to challenge those lies in real time, and again, the tech world can help with this. We need to get the message out like that. That piece of nonsense is no more than a piece of nonsense. If we persistently, consistently do this across all the lies and all the places, we pull the rug from under the populace. Our agency last year had this experience when people said that migrants were bringing sexual violence to Europe. It was in the context of the Cologne attacks. You remember those about a year ago. So we reproduced instantly survey findings of ours on violence against women in Europe, which showed, yes, we've got a very serious problem, but it's our local problem. Don't blame the migrants. And I think we were able to help squash that story quite quickly. But that's just one story. And there's maybe 50 of them out there right now, and they're not being engaged.
Just one more thing of concern. It's that when this happens, it's exported to the democratic countries too. Using the democratic mechanisms. For instance, undemocratic countries sending members to the Council of Europe, to the Parliament, and they vote exactly. for judges who are basically not suitable to sit on the European Court of Human Rights. We have also exporting of this instability to the US through lobbying of these authoritarian, let's say, elites, using the lobbying mechanisms in the US, pouring a lot of money into narratives and then even legal actions within the US which undermine democracy both there and elsewhere. So it is Thank you. Common problem. It's not just one country's little fenced issue.
Either of you want to respond to that, and let's move the mic to the next person.
Yeah, just briefly, work with friendly governments. You mentioned quite rightly this phenomenon where your problematic governments in these multilateral organizations can do some damage. But there's plenty still of friendly governments in those spaces. You can inform them, give them the data they need to push back against these messages. It can make a difference. I've seen it at work in the UN.
However, I'm going to be the however guy. Just for a sec, because there are a number of governments here, and thank you to the 15 or so governments that are actually at RightsCon. There's 185 governments that are not here, and those 15 governments that are here are dealing with those populist movements within their own jurisdiction. And we often say that internet freedom does not just happen overseas, picking up on Cindy's point, it happens at home. So we're seeing the laws, like I mentioned, in Germany, in France, the Investigatory Powers Bill in the UK, and the influence that those governments are then having on the international institutions by not being the kind of not being the standard bearer anymore, not being prepared to stand up to violations in non-democratic countries. And I'll give you another example, which we're seeing as well, which is the issue of the US embassy. For many people, the US embassy has actually been, for better or worse, the safe space, the place that you can go to escape from authorities, the place that you can go to and ask for a diplomatic representation, that is now disappearing. So where do those people go? The Canadian embassy. The Canadian embassies are also under siege as well in terms of their capacity to respond to the numbers. The Dutch government, the Swedish government, etc. So we're actually having governments have increasing pressure on them from all sides. And so it's actually, again, back to, I think, to the citizens and back to us to ensure that the government stays strong. And we've been reinforcing that message, and there are a number of governments here. Again, it's like we need a coalition of progressive states that are willing to stand strong on internet freedom and digital rights, both at home and as part of their foreign policy.
Hi, I'm Javier Ruiz. I work in the UK, mm-hmm. but I'm originally from Spain. Actually, I wanted to talk about both experiences. And so Brexit, you know, we talk in a way, for me, the one thing that stands out and I think is a very difficult challenge is not just so much the populist side, but actually the polarization that it brings. So in a way, it's not that the Brexiteers, they are like 90% of the population. The problem is that society is divided right at the middle. And it's really, really difficult because, you know, at the moment, there's like the claim to majority is so thin that it could be turned over potentially, but it has been built into something that is actually a lot bigger than what it is in terms of number and legitimacy, and I think similar to Trump in the US. So I think that at the same time, it's very difficult for us to, as a digital rights organization, to take a completely active stance against Brexit, and actually we are not doing it. You know, we are saying, because we understand actually that quite a fairly large proportion of our supporters, we are a member-led organization, actually voted for Brexit. Surprising is that there is a whole side of technology, libertarian thing that actually plugged into Brexit, so it makes it very, very difficult for some rights groups. But I think for us, the main problem is how do you deal with this completely divided society, being progressive while not alienating the other people that will support Brexit. So that's quite tricky. And if you think the UK is bad now with Brexit, you should know that Theresa May is actually considering fighting the 2020 election on a promise to pull out of the European, of the Council of, of the European Council. So that's the that's it can get even worse. And then, but the thing that I, in the positive side, what I'm to say, I've been working for the Council of Barcelona in Spain, and I think that helping them do their digital rights strategy, which will include open source and ethical use of data, and it's actually very positive and something that actually they should be celebrating here. And my experience in Barcelona is actually that when we talk about populism, we are using a very reduced framework of what is populism. And the experience in Spain, in the cities of Madrid and Barcelona and quite a few other municipalities, they're actually grassroots organizing has worked. They build local municipal platforms. They are accused of being populist by the traditional parties. They say, oh, you're populist, you know, and lumped in the same way of, you know, with Marine Le Pen and, you know, other groups. But actually, these people are implementing human rights at the municipal level. They're welcoming refugees. They're bringing digital rights into the municipality and things. So I think that would be, I mean, those would be one of the positive examples I think we can use, no, of another kind of populism, you know, being possible and not just the model of the right.
Yes. I'll pass it to Bruce, and then we'll get a response from the panel, because there's a number of questions.
So I'm very interested in what happens in the world when the United States falls from its leadership hub position. You talked about other countries. I mean, when we lose the embassies, the State Department, pull out of treaties, what is the coalition that takes its place? Just because it's been so central for much of the last century, and there's a very real chance it's going to go away.
Yep. I mean, maybe either of you would like to respond to that.
I jump in on the first gentleman's observations around populism. Your example of Barcelona and the way the word populism gets used is a good reminder of why I don't like the word. It conflates too many entirely different things. Engaging people to make a difference in their lives it may be popular and may work. That doesn't make it populism. So it's what you're doing, and I've heard so many good stories out of Barcelona in terms of bringing human rights alive at the local level. But I want to answer your question, because it's not just the Brexit vote, but I'm also thinking of the Austrian vote, which wasn't dissimilar, you know, almost 50-50 in terms of who people went for. And the 50 that vote the way you don't like, you know, that vote for the thing you don't want, they're not bad people. And there are many perfectly reasonable people there. And we need to point the finger at ourselves. And from my business of promoting human rights, say that we have failed. We have failed with our language, with our means of communication, and we've got to wake up and do a much better job. We gave some examples earlier, but even the business of language. Is the language too technical? Is the language too pokey? Is it too private for a small elite? Should we be talking more about dignity, fairness, things? You know, don't pull away from the standards that we're committed to, but transmit them, engage them, motivate people using words that work for them. The Irish marriage equality referendum was won with 70%, not using language of human rights, but languages of fairness, dignity, and equality. I think there's a lesson to be learned from that.
Yeah, I would really like to echo that. I do think that there are a lot of people who are feeling like they want change. They're feeling like the current system isn't serving them, and to me the fundamental problem is that they're picking bad solutions to real problems. And so stepping back and thinking about how can those of us who believe in the fundamental values of human rights make them part of the right answer, because I think that they are, and make them accessible. For Bruce's question, I mean, that is a really hard question. I know that there are people within the kind of, you know, who hope that Germany and the remainder of the EU, the people who are committed to the European idea, can rise and become a kind of world leadership around these kinds of values. That would be great. I'm nervous. I'm not so sure that that's true. I think that I can't see for sure whether that's going to happen one way or the other. It would be nice, because I think this, you know, this idea that while I think that Michael's earlier comment resonated with me, which is the idea that, you know, we used to have a human rights framework and protection of human rights that was violated all the time. We've never been good at enforcement. We've never been good at making real the vision. But what we're seeing now is people thinking that's not the right vision anymore. We've lost the hypocrisy, right? The sense of outrage that if you deviate from this, you're in trouble and there is a problem that we need to solve. And I think some of that is because there's been no accountability for the problems, right? Nobody went to jail over Abu Ghraib. Nobody high enough in the chain, none of the deciders. In the surveillance issues, we've never been able to do this. In the torture issues, the wonderful case that the ACLU is doing in the United States, trying to bring some of the people who organize the torture things, struggling over issues. And this is all seen by people around the world as like, your world doesn't create any accountability. So while I might agree with your lofty ideas, they're not serving me, so I'm going to go with somebody who's got power, who can actually protect me, who can protect my job. They're picking the wrong solution to a real problem. And so how do we make that not so attractive, right? How do we bring real solutions on the side that it supports people's rights and freedoms is, I think, the challenge for all of us in the room.
Thank you. If I'll just respond to Bruce quickly, and then we'll see if there's other responses in terms of like, how do we actually deal with the vacuum that the US government is leaving behind? Firstly, I think it's really important that we don't give up on the US government. Like, there are many amazing organizations, institutions, and people still working within government who are standing up to ensure that there is still compliance with human rights. So, you know, people within the State Department who are here, actively participating. There's the courts in place which are seeing cases from the EFF and the ACLU coming down on the right side of the line. Of course, we're concerned that the case, that like we're relying upon the courts, and the courts is like a, you know, to ensure that non-constitutional, for instance, activities and laws are found so. But we're then relying upon those who are appointed in those positions. So, like, we do have a real structural issue here. But I think it's a really important message that activists and within the US and people outside of the US don't give up on the US. And I've heard that numerous times at this conference. The Freedom Online Coalition is also a coalition of progressive states that are standing firm in principle on digital rights. But I spoke at the European Parliament the day before yesterday and looked at which members of the European Union are members of the Freedom Online Coalition, and it's 50-50. There are at least half of the governments within the European Union are not in the Freedom Online Coalition, which is deeply problematic because that's the coalition of states. It's the coalition of digital, of country, the coalition of the willing on digital rights, and they're not performing in the way that they need to. So, I mean, you know, and then it's the protection of the institutions to ensure organizations like the OSCE who are here, that, you know, from the freedom of the Office of the Freedom of the Media, that they're actually holding governments to account, that the European Parliament, which is also meant to hold to account the European Commission and the Council, that they're actually doing their job. So there are many, many safeguards, but I think it's important for us as, again, as citizens and as organizations, like all of us are here because we actually have agency. And so this rallying that you talked about, like we've never seen so many members of the ACLU, we've never seen so many members of the EFF. It's not a brilliant answer. I'm hoping that there'll also be more brilliant answers in the audience. It's hundreds of you. No.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, of course, please.
Thanks, I'm Fabio Chiusi from Italy, I'm a journalist. Just to add a layer of complexity here, in Italy it's the opposite. You know, we have populists or so-called populists defending basic digital rights, and the progressives and conservatives that are actually threatening it. And you actually saw it with a proposal on fake news that just came out that all of the parliament signed, yeah, except for the Five Star Movement, except for one guy who immediately deleted the signature. But, you know, it's the so-called populists who are defending the rights. So my opinion is that, you know, this word, we should get rid of this, all of this populist framework and talk about human rights or digital rights offenders, because the picture, when you open it up to the whole world, is so complicated, and you actually saw what happened. You know, even the NSA scandal was built up out of Bush administration and Obama administration, so-called non-populist administrations, you know. So I think if we have to search for an answer, we have to get rid first of this theoretical framework, which doesn't work, I think, that is a populist framework.
Thank you.
I agree with that.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Beth Shiner from Middlesex University. I just want to ask a question about how to facilitate meaningful, genuine engagement with people. I might be wrong, but I understood from the Ireland referendum that before the vote was cast, there was a process of deliberation with with groups of citizens who were talking about it and were discussing it and throwing out ideas. So can we pool resources together and exploit routes that already exist that give us access to the mainstream? So for example, exploiting the BBC, for example, as a perfect platform to have a debate with citizens, no politicians there, but with maybe experts, with lawyers, from people from different sides, because we obviously need to have a really meaningful discussion. And yes, we run the risk that it could be hijacked by whoever, but the only way we really confront it or deal with it, I think, is we talk about it head on. So what do you think about that?
I'm going to give a kind of a geeky response because I can't add much to what you said. It's a perfectly sensible idea. But just remember that consultation and participation in public affairs is actually a human right. It's an explicit human right in the treaties to which our countries have signed up. So it is not just a good idea. It's something we must insist on. I have no brief here to speak for anything Irish, but right now there's an interesting experiment in consultation going on through a people's convention, which is discussing, they were arbitrarily chosen through some complicated formula, you know, randomly rather, chosen to discuss really tough issues of constitutional reform, such as on the matter of abortion, for example. And it seems to be working reasonably well, but let me not say any more than that. But since you're looking at it from a university point of view, maybe that Irish experience is one you could study.
I got that, if anyone's interested, from a book by David Van Raybrook, who's talked about against elections, but he's specifically looking at deliberation and participatory democracy. But I think that model can be applied to lots of these issues.
Mm. And the great thing, of course, about new technology is that it is possible to engage very large numbers. The problem is, like, even if you look at, like, you know, when Facebook did its crowdsourcing of its privacy policies, like, it's very difficult to actually get that kind of engagement unless you have that real like connection with people's everyday lives. And I think that's the hard nut to crack. But we still come back to the loss of people's confidence and trust in the institutions that govern them. And I think that maybe there is an opportunity for internet governance to be a new model, maybe this sort of multi-stakeholder model that brings together government, civil society, companies, academics, technologists into a kind of a new form of governance that enables greater trust, participation, engagement, and outcomes that actually deliver the things that people are looking for in their real lives.
I don't know, maybe. I've been involved in multi-stakeholder conversations, and they usually make me want to pull my hair out one by one. So I think that there's lots of room to work to make those work for people, and especially work for busy people. I think that part of our challenge is to try to figure out, people are scared now and they want to get engaged. People are scared and were engaged and thought that they could vote for this big man and that he would protect them, right? That the story is on both sides. And so how do we create space for people to be able to think about things and still go on, you know, and still make their lives work? Some of this involves, creating some social, some space for people so that they're not just at their wit's end all the time, so they can have the time to be reflective. And that's a big problem. And I do think that I love your idea, but
well, let me respond to you just real quick, because it is the internet itself is the result of the multi-stakeholder model. I mean, it is fraught, but the actual governance of the internet did not come and is not as a result of multilateral. It is a result of ICANN and ISOC and IEEE and IETF and all of the bodies that have worked together, and which includes technologists, governments, companies, civil societies, and that's where we're up to here. I mean, it is a model that sits outside of the UN. We fought, many of us, to keep the governance of the internet outside of the UN, through Wicked, etc., and we've been successful to a date. So I totally agree with you. It's absolutely frustrating, but it is also delivering results in terms of participation, engagement, and I think also a platform which is being attacked, absolutely, the open internet, but is still here.
Yeah, but don't overclaim for the internet as a communication space. There's still a remarkably high percentage of people in most of our countries that are not even computer literate,
yeah.
And so they're not there. And so you can't divine the will of society today from using solely new internet methodologies. The other thing I have in mind is we need to get into this. We need to introduce into this discussion at some point how can we mine big data in a human rights respectful way to understand what people want in society. I think there's a number of sessions on that, including not only mining but also
collecting and storing and then using. Indeed. All right, I think we need to
close. Oh gosh, that's scary and a whole other topic, but let me just point for the record that I think that the same problem that you have articulated about how half the world's population is online points directly to the problem to trying to mine the data that's online to solve society's problems. We say garbage in, garbage out in tech. If you've only got half the world's population feeding into it, the answers you're gonna get out are not gonna serve. They're going to reinforce the biases of the haves versus the have-nots. So do not go down that road without checking with me more.
On that front, can I ask you to thank the panel? Thanks very much for your time.